Hello everybody, I hope you're doing well today. So the goal for today's video is to talk in general about the main topic for the course, which is functions of multiple variables. And by the end of the day, our goal, we have three things that we should be able to do. We should be able to define this term multivariable function and give an example of such a function, perhaps both mathematically and in terms of real-world examples. We also want to be able to plug a certain point into a multivariable function. We want to be able to evaluate it. And finally, we want to be able to describe the domain of some multivariable functions, describe the points that can go in to the multivariable function. Those are our goals for today. So to begin with, I'd just like to start with an informal discussion of what this course is sort of going to be all about. And so let's get started with a historical point of view. Way back in algebra, an introduction was given for the idea of a single variable function, which took an input, which is traditionally called x when you first get started, runs it through some kind of machine, some kind of rule, and then outputs a function, another variable, which is usually called y. Y is a function of x. And as you went through algebra 1 and then pre-calculus and trigonometry, you're introduced to all the elementary functions. So-called elementary because they are the elements of more complicated function. If you put together the elementary functions by adding, multiplying, dividing, composing them, by multiplying them by constants, you can get a huge variety of different functions which represent a variety of real-world situations. And these included things like polynomial functions, rational, things like the square root functions and other radical functions, things like exponential and its inverse, the logarithm, and the trigonometric functions. Then you moved on to calculus, and you learned how to take these single variable functions, and you learned how to take their derivative, and this is in Calc 1, and you learned how to take their antiderivative, their integral, and this was in Calc 2. And finally, in Calc 3, you considered the possibility that your function took in a single number, usually called t, and it didn't output a single number called y, but perhaps output an ordered list of numbers, output a vector of numbers, x of t, y of t, or maybe it was a three-dimensional vector, x, y, and z. So what we have studied up to this point all are functions which take a single input variable. And what we're going to be studying in this course are functions which take in multiple input variables. A multivariable function is a function with more than one input variable. So, as a real-world example, there are several. I would say that it's more common in life to encounter a multivariable function than it is to encounter a single variable function. Because, you know, most things in life depend on more than one input quantity to determine their outcome. For example, suppose that I was considering a function that I could use to determine my academic performance in school, what you might call grades. There are a lot of factors that go into determining a student's academic performance, or at least what determined my academic performance. For example, the level of self-care was a huge determining factor. If I wasn't eating properly, if I didn't get enough sleep, if I didn't get enough water, it was severely going to impact my cognition, my ability to remember things and think clearly and make sense of what I was hearing. So self-care affected, you know, the ability that I had to do good academic work. But not just self-care. Of course, the time that you spent doing work, studying, had an effect. Now, for me, the primary determiners of how well I did academically were number of practice exercises. You know, going to class and watching videos and reading the book were all well and good, but for me, nothing compared to actually working problems from the back of the book. That was one of the primary determiners for me for academic performance. And finally, I would say that the other thing that really affected my academic performance and grades was the number of classes that I attended. Because when you attend class, you really get a good sense of what your professor thinks is important or not important, your professor's style and taste. You get an idea of what kind of exam questions they're going to write. And so all three of these factors influenced my academic performance. And this would be a real-life example of a function with three input variables, for example. Now, in my free time, my quarantine hobby was to try and learn how to use the Unity game engine to make my own game. And part of that is to learn how to do some light programming in the programming language C#. And so here is a script that I'm working on for this hobby game that I'm trying to create. And here we'll see several examples of functions with one input variable, usually an item. But here you have an example of a function with two input variables, one quantity called an item and one integer called quality level. So even in my hobbies, you know, I'm finding functions of two or three variables coming up quite often. Okay, so let's give a mathematical example of a function of more than one variable. Let's give a mathematical example, and the notation that we'll use is function name, parenthesis, but instead of just putting x, we'll put a list of two variables, f of x, comma, y. Now, the output for this x and this y will be determined by the following rule: square x, and then add 2 times the y value. For example, if I decide to plug in the specific value x equals 3 and y equals negative 1, then the corresponding output can be found by taking 3 squared and adding 2 times negative 1, which is, of course, 7, if I've got my arithmetic correct. This is an example of evaluating a function of two variables using its given equation. Take the number in the x slot and plug it in for all the x's in the formula. Take the number in the y slot, plug it in for all the y's in the formula. Let's get another example going. Here we have a function, and the letter f is missing, let's just write that in. We have a function of 1, 2, 3 variables, which are called x, y, and z. For this function, defined by this formula given here, let's evaluate f of negative 2, comma 1, comma 3. So, negative 2 has come into the x's position. So, in this entire formula, I'm going to scan through, and instead of x squared, I'm going to replace that with negative 2 squared. I'm going to scan through this formula, and everywhere I see a y, I'm going to replace it with the given y value of 1. So, not times y, but times 1, minus 2 times 1. And instead of dividing by z, we're going to divide by the given z coordinate, which is 3. So, all in total, we have 12, take away 2/3. This is something 34 over 3, and assuming the arithmetic has worked out correctly, this would be the answer to the question, evaluate this function at this point. So that's the idea of evaluating. Take the x, y, z that are given to you and plug them into their appropriate positions in the formula. Now suppose with this same function, that we were asked to evaluate f of 5, 2, 0, for example. So instead of 3x squared y, we will now have 3, 5 squared 2. Instead of minus 2y, we'll have minus 2 times 2. And instead of over z, we'll have over 0. So automatically, as a result of dividing by 0 here, we got something that was undefined. In fact, based on what we're seeing here, if we try and plug in any point with a 0 in the z coordinate, then the result will be undefined no matter what. If z is 0, we cannot plug that point into the function. So let's make a note of that. Function is undefined at all points where the z-coordinate is 0. Now, if I take a close look at this function, the division by 0 is the only part of this formula that really has the potential to break down. If I imagine plugging any other point into this formula, so long as z is not 0, the result of these calculations should be a well-defined number. And ideas like that give us some basic principles when we go to calculate the domain of a multivariable function. The domain being the collection of all the points, all the inputs which can be plugged in to the function. Same meaning that we had for single variable functions. And just as we did with single variable functions, there are three main principles that lead and guide us when we're looking at the domain. The first being that we can't divide by 0 under any circumstances. The second being that we can't square root a negative number, not if we're staying in the real realm. We won't be dealing with complex numbers in this class at all. And finally, we can't take a logarithm of a non-positive number. You can't take the logarithm of 0, and you can't take a logarithm of any negative number. And this is true not only for the common log, but the logarithm of any base, whether it be log base e, the natural log, or any other logarithm such as log base 2. So let's use those guiding principles to describe the domain of the following function. The function of two variables, f of xy, equals the square root of 4 minus x squared minus y squared. Now, based on principle number 2 here, if we are living in the real world and not allowing ourselves to go into the realm of complex numbers, then the thing that we're taking the square root of, the 4 minus x squared minus y squared, has to be greater than or equal to 0. It has to be non-negative. Now, if I rearrange that a bit, that means that x squared plus y squared should be smaller than 4. That way, if you subtract it from 4, you get a positive result. So the domain of this function is a disk. We can plug in any x, y, which is contained within a circle of radius 2 in the x, y plane. For emphasis, let's just draw a sketch of it. Here's the domain. The domain is the set of all x's and y's where the distance from the origin is either equal to 2 or anything smaller than 2 is fine as well. The domain of this function is the disk in the xy plane. Now, our traditional way for writing the domain of a function like this one is in set builder notation. So for example, I would write something like the collection of all the pairs x and y, which satisfy the following condition: x squared plus y squared less than or equal to 0. To describe the domain, I would write this: the set of all pairs x and y satisfying the condition x squared plus y squared less than or equal to 4, aka the disk of radius 2 in the xy plane. Let's try as well to describe the domain of f of xyz defined by the following function: 3xy squared divided by z times the quantity 3x plus y. Now, guiding principle number 3 says to us, number 1 says to us that we cannot divide by 0. So let's isolate the denominator here and let's specify that z, 3x plus y, is not allowed to be 0. That means that first, z can't be 0. Because if z were 0, it would wipe out the entire quantity on the left. In addition to that, 3x plus y can't be 0, or if you prefer, y can't be equal to negative 3x. Both of these must be true simultaneously, because if either z is 0 or y equals negative 3x, the denominator will become 0, and that will break the function. So I will write the domain of this function in set builder notation as follows: the set of all the inputs x, y, z satisfying the following condition. The first thing is that the z coordinate must be non-zero. And I also require that the y-coordinate not be equal to 3 times the x-coordinate. So long as both of these conditions are satisfied, the point will be in the domain. So that's our process for finding the domain of a multivariable function. Use those 3 guiding principles and apply them to your formula for your function to describe what must be true or what must be false about your x, y, and z. And then put those conditions together in set builder notation as here. All right, that concludes our first video. Now I am definitely expecting that as you go and you work on today's problems, both the online homework and the concept check, and if you have any questions, or that if you're still confused about anything, if you want any additional resources, that you ask for help, that you ask a question if you're confused, that you ask for resources if you need any more. So, if I don't hear from you, what can I assume except I explained everything perfectly all the time, you have no confusion whatsoever, right? But please don't hesitate to ask a question if you have one. That's what I'm here for, to answer any questions that you might have. All right, good luck with today's work, and I'll see you tomorrow for the next video.